C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
Well, remember, go ahead, Bryan.
September, they're supposed to expire the unemployment benefits, federal benefits, $300 extra a week. And obviously, Governor Hogan says it's time to get rid of them. Basically, right now in the state of Maryland, and Republican governors are the ones that are eliminating these. Democratic governors are keeping them for the time being. And will this become a political issue? Because starting to be some cold water, I think, for Democrats on this issue. But there are many in the state of Maryland that say the governor is dead wrong in getting rid of these federal unemployment benefits, the $300. Peter Franchot is one of them. He's the Maryland Comptroller. He's also a candidate for governor. Great to have you on.
Good
morning, sir.
I didn't know you two guys were partnering. I guess I missed that.
What have you been listening to for the last year? That's what I would like to know. Have you not been commuting to work in the morning? Is that what it is?
No, but I feel a little bit like a cicada, so I'm coming out of the earth here and blinking my eyes at you guys. But thanks. I'm delighted to be with you. My best wishes to your listeners. And if I could just say just a moment of empathy for folks that have suffered from the COVID virus. It is a nasty, nasty thing. I'm glad it's being put behind us, but it caused a lot of grief in Maryland, that's for sure.
Absolutely has. Well, for last year, we've actually talked a lot about you. I want you to know that. All right, so let's start with the unemployment aspect of it and these benefits that the governor is getting rid of. You say keep them. Make the case on why you think that we should, you know, have them until the September when they're set to sunset from the federal government.
Okay, well, bear with me just for a minute, because for a year and a half, this unemployment thing has been an anchor around the state's neck. In the comptroller's office, we answer 800,000 phone calls a year within 40 seconds. How did that happen? We have remote call centers. We invest in infrastructure. We invest in hardware and software and all the stuff, training that you need to do to be able to do that. They never did that at the Department of Labor and still haven't. So people have trouble getting through. Number two, we process 4 million tax returns. We get refunds back $3 billion in 2.5 business days. They don't have the infrastructure at the Department of Labor. Therefore, the entire system has been blocked. Then thirdly, finally, most importantly, we have a world-renowned or nationally recognized fraud detection unit that prevents the Maryland Treasury from being looted by crooks with false refund requests. They don't have that at the Department of Labor. They've given out $13 billion in unemployment payments in the last year and a half. It's estimated that $1.5 billion went to crooks. I mean, fraud. And that's unacceptable. So on top of that, we now have this situation. It continues to be a huge problem. And I think it's one of the reasons why people are so frustrated and on short leash. Now we come to the $300 situation. I would hope the future governors would say, we get more money, we get more results with honey than vinegar. The carrot is better than the stick. Why don't we offer a $300 bonus to anybody coming back to work? Rather than penalizing and, using a stick on people to take money away from them. What's ironic here is that it's federal money. It isn't even Maryland money. And it's specially designated not just to low-wage earners. It's also designated to single employers and also gig employers, whatever they are, if someone could explain that to me. but the gig employees have been left out. So the federal Congress put in monies for Maryland, and they designated it for these groups. And we decided to pull it. Now, is that a problem? Yes, number one. Number two, I've been comptroller for 14 years. Every year at the same time, I hear the same complaints from a lot of folks who I think at night sit on a bar stool somewhere and just grouse about things. They say, gosh darn it, people are lazy and they're not coming back to work. I've had a help wanted sign out front of my business for 2 weeks and nobody's applied. Okay, I think that's part of the complexity of the Maryland market and the economy. But let me just conclude by saying 2 days or 3 days ago, I was in Owings Mill at the Mill Station mall. And we were cutting the ribbon with the county exec and the head of the county council. This was just on Monday for the sixth franchise of the Towson Hot Bagel Group. That's the Scotto family from Towson.
Okay.
They have this unbelievable bagel business. Okay, so we show up. It's a packed place. It's high energy. We're all vaccinated, so we don't have to wear a mask. Or I didn't wear a mask, and I felt great. What did they have there? 25 young adults that they'd hired in the last 2 weeks. I said, how'd you guys do that? And this was like a energetic group of young people. They all had T-shirts on. They were all new employees. They were doing chants like an athletic team. They were they did a common prayer together, and they were like ready to go when the public showed up. I said, how'd you guys do that? They said, we had to go out and recruit people. It wasn't something that just happened. We just didn't put a help wanted sign.
Well, Comptroller, let me ask you this, Comptroller.
So it went on. I don't mean to go on and on, but
let me ask you though.
Check out the bagel place.
Not only do I check out THB. Hey, look, I'm a regular customer of THB. They all have a Mitchell account there by now, considering how many. They're fantastic. I might have been there for the sixth one opening. But Comptroller Peter Franchot, when it comes to this issue, we had Maryland State Senator Jim Rosapep on the show. And Senator Rosapep and I go way back, just like I do with you. We all served together at one point in the House of Delegates. But Senator Rosapep made no secret about the fact that the extension is $300 benefit that goes to September is nothing more than trying to drive up wages in the private sector to make sure if you want these people back, raise your wages so that you get them back. And the question that Bryan Nehman and I had, Comptroller French, I want to ask you is that, you know, how fair is it for businesses to have to compete against the government when it comes to raising wage? It's not a free market situation.
I'm not saying it's easy to be in the private sector now. But we have a fabulous system in our country. It's called free enterprise. It's going to be okay. It's complicated. It takes a long time to get back to normal. We don't just flip a switch and all of a sudden go from cicadas under the ground to, back to our normal economy. It's difficult. So I have a lot of respect for Senator Roosevelt. I'm surprised he's not running for comptroller because he would have been a great candidate, but such is life. So, yes, inflation of wages is an issue for our experts because obviously we are concerned about inflation, interest rate, the stock market wobbling. We don't want to have bad things happen. We think it's more or less under control. But what we're talking about with this $300, the low wage earners primarily, there are about 200,000 of them, and then there are 100,000 gig workers on top, who actually need the help, and it phases out September 6th. So I thought it was a little bit of a pile-on political, cynical effort to, somehow pit Republicans against Democrats.
Well, do you admit that there is a labor shortage right now, right? I mean, we hear stories all the time. I mean, we have convenience stores that are offering $500 signing bonuses, $1,000 if you stay for a month. I mean, that kind of stuff is unheard of, right, in our lifetime, to be honest with you.
I'm not saying it's hard. But small businesses, and it's easy for small businesses to find labor. Obviously, it is. I just mentioned the place that's adding pounds daily to C4's.
Well, do you know how much they're offering? I'm curious. Do you know how much they're offering? How much hourly they're paying these people to come?
It's not a huge amount because they're offering something even better, which is to be part of a team, and they emphasize family and love and passion and excellence, and we're all in this together. And as I said, they were like a high school football team or basketball team. They all had their arms around each other. They were, saying chants. They were praying together. And it makes a difference if you go out and you're recruiting, not just, hey, come on in and work at a job that we're going to pay you for, but it's no different from any other job in a convenience store. If what you're saying is that you want to penalize people, and you want to punish them by taking money from them if they don't go back to work, that I have a big problem with. I think it's wrong at this point. It's about to expire.
You're not penalizing them because it's money that they're getting from taxpayers for not working. That's the big difference.
Bryan, let me just say, you must have a, instead of a heart, you must have a piece of coal down there. This is I just can't emphasize that it is money. And on top of helping the recipients, and it's something that was promised to them, they budgeted for it. If I could just say very quickly, if I ever did this to the business community, for example, I've given them, businesses don't have to pay taxes until July 15th this year because of me, of the state taxes. If I walked out of this meeting with you guys and said, hey, I'm tired of this. I think we're going to have to change that. And I want all the taxes paid, not July 15th, a month from now, but at the end of the week. Otherwise, I'm going to apply interest rates and penalties. People would have me drawn and quartered, the business community. They would say, we budgeted for that. We prepared for that. You told us that we were going to get it. Well, we did the same thing with these people. The federal government said, we're going to do this for you. They made a promise, and now the rug's been pulled out. But the other key thing is our experts have done an economic review, and they say there's $1.5 billion of economic investment and activity that's going down the drain voluntarily. And that would help businesses, Bryan and Seaford.
We're definitely not going to see eye to eye on this one, only because we actually hear we hear from the businesses, really. We hear from the businesses calling, and Brian's talking about it as well, that say they can't find employees. But I do have to ask you before we let you go, Comptroller.
Can I just interrupt for a minute? Because
sure.
I have heard that every year for 14 years, it's a seasonal complaint. And a lot of the businesses around the state, the big ones that do the most complaining, they've got dozens of foreign workers being flown in right now as we speak.
But there are 8.1 million jobs open. That's according to the Biden administration in reference to the extra money. But let's move on to one other.
I'm just talking Maryland, guys.
Right.
Maryland has got an unbelievably bright future. We just have to make sure we do re-emphasize this customer service. We explain to people what's going on. And we don't pull the rug out from underneath folks that have been counting on this money.
Well, let me ask you this before we let you go, Comptroller, because you were out front on this long before Governor Hogan came into office. And once again, we had to close about 30 schools in the city, about 6 schools in Baltimore County, because of a lack of consistent air conditioning. And this situation just continues. I saw you on Twitter comment about this the other day. I mean, it just, you would think by now, with all this money particularly coming in, they would correct some of this stuff, Comptroller.
Okay. Great question. And on Saturday, I was in Dundalk at a big barbecue, going around shaking hands, you know, doing the gubernatorial thing. And the guy looked up at me from the table and he said, I'm a truck driver. I said, no, that's great. He said, I got something that you can do as governor. You can pick up the trash on state roads, because when I drive from Maryland into Virginia, it's like going from a trash heap into something that's really clean. And he said, Maryland's even worse than Pennsylvania. That got me going, because I showed him the forms. I held them up in the air, all my pledges, and I said, I'm going to, first 6 months as governor, fix every pothole, pick up the trash along state roads, and have every state agency answer phone calls like we do in the Comptroller's office. He said, great, you got my vote. That was terrific. I walked away and said, oh, boy, that's fabulous. I'm adding a fourth pledge right now. If I'm elected governor in the first 6 months, we're going to put a heating and cooling unit into every single unair-conditioned classroom and unheated classroom in the city of Baltimore. No ifs, ands, or buts. If I have to do it myself, I'll do it. The technology is there. We should have done it years ago. You can plug it into the existing electrical infrastructure. I'll get the IBEW Local 24 to help us. The items are sold on the market. They're inexpensive. And, you know, I'm not talking about window units. I'm talking about the creme de la creme, where you just stick it through the wall, you plug it into the electrical system.
And it's heat and air. It's not just air. It's heat and air.
And air. And I'm sick and tired of us politicians getting up there and saying we're going to fix this. No, we're not going to fix it, because we're not very good at deliverables. I'm good at deliverables, and I'm adding that fourth component. So you guys can hold my feet to the fire.
We will. Last question before I let you go, and that is Republicans want you to apologize to Dr. Robert Redfield for your comments about him back in March regarding the Wuhan lab theory that a lot of people are now believing is certainly a sensible position to have. Do you have any intention on apologizing to Dr. Robert Redfield?
No, not at all, because my complaint was that it fomented hate crimes against Asian Americans.
How did that foment hate crimes?
Because it fed into your party's version of Trumpian.
Okay. First of all, I'm an independent. First of all, I'm an independent. Second of all, it's about the Chinese government. Well, there is a big difference between the communist Chinese murderous government and Asian people, is there not?
There has been a stark increase in Asian American hate crimes because of your candidate, Trump, and his comments about China.
I did not vote for Donald Trump.
He's more critical of Trump. Comptroller, he's more critical of Trump sometimes than I am.
I'll let you guys go. You're going to get me riled up. But no,
so you have no intention of apologizing to him, even though there are a lot of people who now believe that it did, in fact, start from a lab in Wuhan.
The timing was egregiously unfortunate, and that was what got under my skin when I read about Asian Americans being run up and run over and clobbered and beaten up and shot and killed. And I attribute that to this, politicization of the pandemic. So let's stop politicizing things. How about it? Why would all Republican governors take the $300 back and try to coddle up the businesses? And why would all the Democratic governors not? Because it's political. Can't we stop that?
Comptroller Peter Franchot, as always, it is a blast. Thank you so much, and we'll be talking with you down the campaign trail.